And they throw all those out and we say, we'll just do praise and worship instead.
Yeah.
We don't want to sing scriptures. Why? Because they're convicting. We don't want to sing hymns because they're uplifting. Hymns lift up Christ.
Yep.
Right.
And we don't want to sing spiritual songs because together they are convicting and uplifting. They lift up Christ and put us in our place. We just want to sing praise and worship, we call it. And I'm going to be honest with you. I'm careful with the terminology just because some of the songs and little things that we used to sing, the little choruses we sang as children, are now called praise and worship. And they'll take some of those and they'll put them into their music and singing. And they'll come as praise and worship, and as part of their world, they will take things. I don't remember what it was. Amazing Grace, I think, was the rights to it at one time were bought by a rock and roll group. And because over years, you can, I don't remember how it all played out, or it was claimed that it was. And so some people were saying, well, you can't sing that song anymore because who has the rights to it? I'm like, you don't understand. That's not how and why we sing what we sing, because of who owns the rights to it. We sing songs that are psalms, hymns, or spiritual songs that are praising and uplifting God. And anything that has a hint of the flesh or the world in it, we don't sing. We get rid of it. We've got to be caught. And I think the Bible is very clear. In our singing, there ought to be a solemnness to it. There ought to be. Mm-hmm. And that doesn't mean we all sing with our heads down, eyes closed, and in a mournful, chanting way that some of those monkish individuals do. That's not what it means. That's piety. That's not solemn. That's just, look at me, I'm going to mind my P's and Q's. We have been going through our Sunday school lesson in Revelation and in prophetic view per se, but we have to remember this. You have to remember that it's all about Jesus Christ, or you're wasting your time studying prophecy or even scripture for that matter. If you lose focus on Jesus Christ, you're wasting your time. Now, most of the time, if you study false doctrines, false religions, and things like that, you'll find that they are founded by two different types of people. People that are lost and on their way to a devil's hell. They're caught up in whatever it may be. They're caught up in religion, maybe. They're caught up in witchcraft. They're caught up in the arts, they call it, or whatever. They're caught up in something, and they get this feel good, and they go to the Bible, even, and they start reading, and oh, it just becomes a new world to them. Well, they don't have a discerning spirit. The Holy Spirit's not present. They're lost. And so they can easily get scriptures twisted and manipulated and come up with anything. Then you have another group that may be saved, but so far off because no one's ever discipled them. No one's ever taught them anything. That would be a rare, rare, rare group. Study it out. Those that start false doctrines and false teachings, I think pretty much a majority of the time, if not all, but I think there may be some that have been started by people who just... And the reason I say it is because I've sat in Bible college. And I've heard young men who I believe were saved, that loved God, they got up to give a message and they just, in their understanding, maybe they read somebody else and they heard from somebody else, they get up and preach a message. And in there's some things that are slightly off. And they need guidance. And that's not where it says. But if you allow stuff like that to go, then it could lead to other beliefs. So I believe there, even a believer, like I said before, even I have used the scripture out of context before and went back and read and like, I can't believe I did that. I need to get it right, correct that. Because sometimes we get into the flesh. Man, I learned something new. Well, technically it's not new. His mercies are new, but the scriptures aren't really new. And though I learned something I might think is new, if I didn't go to scripture and compare scripture with scripture, I might have made up something new. So that's where we have to be careful. So as we're going through Revelation, we're going to get to a point now where we've seen John says he's standing before the throne. You have 24 elders in their seats. You have four beasts. You have the Lamb coming from the throne. He turns and takes the book from the Father. He takes that book and it's sealed with seven seals. We're about to see something that is now very, very mind-boggling. There's a lot of things that I'm going to be honest with you, I don't completely understand. And I don't believe I ever will on this side of eternity. I believe that. I believe there are some things, even when Jesus gave clarity on his death, burial, and resurrection. The apostles said what? They didn't have a clue that he was going to rise from the dead. And after he rose from the dead, and after they realized, oh, that's what he was telling us. Well, you're dumb. He was so explanatory. He was so clear. Why were the apostles so dumb? It's not that they were dumb. And sometimes we don't have a clear human understanding of how God speaks. Sometimes he doesn't give perfect clarity for us. Why? Because I think many times as Christians and believers, we're going to try to maneuver and manipulate the hand of God. We're going to make it come about. I told my dad in a joke once. I said, the Bible says, in the end, before Jesus comes, there's going to be wars and rumors of wars. So if I want to do my part to further the cause of Christ and bring Christ back faster, I'm going to start some rumors. And maybe even some wars to help get that going. He looked at me. I said, I'm just joking, Dad. I'm not going to do that. But you know how our mind thinks. We can get God here faster if we can hurry up the end times events. If we can make it. And so I think God gives clarity, but I don't think our human mind always has enough clarity when we look back and realize, wow, that's what he said, and that's how he was going to work. Why did I try to work it out myself? Why did I try to maneuver and manipulate the hand of God and make it work out how I think it should work out? And so there's some things in there. I don't understand seeing a lamb with seven horns and seven eyes. I know what they represent, but I can't understand the visual picture, the visual image. Myself, I've just never seen anything that looks like that. So I don't completely, in my human understanding, if you want to draw me a picture and tell me this is what it looks like, you go right ahead. Okay? And if your drawing's as good as mine, I'll say, what is it? But we've moved on into Revelation chapter 6. We've gone through chapter 5. You have the image of all the four beasts, the 24 elders, the Lamb taking the book from the Father, the book with the seven seals. And in chapter 6, he is about to open the seven seals. One at a time, he is going to open the seals. And each one of those seals has a representation. We're going to go through very quickly and very briefly, temporarily, right now. And then I'm going to step away from Revelation chapter 6. Okay? Revelation chapter 6, verse 1. Says, and I saw when the Lamb opened one of the seals, and I heard, as it were, the noise of thunder, one of the four beasts saying, come and see. Now I think, if you want to know what beast that was, there was four beasts, remember? They were given a specific order. So I think if you go back real quick and look at the order, you'd see the lion is mentioned first, voice like thunder. It sounds like he's going in the same order and clarity of the beast, each one of them giving their voice to it. But the significance of the beasts is not that big a deal. The significance of who is opening the seals, that's who we want to focus on. Because the beasts, they just do as they're told. They really don't have any say in it. They're not that big of a focus. They're just there. They have a part, but the focus is on Christ, the one opening the seals. It says this. So, and I heard as it were the noise of thunder, one of the four beasts saying, come and see. And I saw and behold a white horse, and he that sat on him had a bow. And a crown was given unto him, and he went forth conquering and to conquer. When he had opened the second seal, I heard a second beast say, come and see. He doesn't give any clarity or description of the next beasts. He just leaves them be. But I think he's just showing that in the same order that he's been given, each one of them has an opportunity to speak out. Verse 4, and there went out another horse that was red, and power was given to him that sat thereon to take peace from the earth, and that they should kill one another, and there was given unto him a great sword. And when he opened the third seal, I heard the third beast say, come and see. And I beheld, and lo, a black horse, and he that sat on him had a pair of balances in his hand. And I heard a voice in the midst of the four beasts say, a measure of wheat for a penny, and three measures of barley for a penny, and see that thou hurt not the oil and the wine. And when he had opened the fourth seal, I heard the voice of the fourth beast say, come and see. And I looked, and behold, a pale horse, and his name that sat on him was Death, and hell followed with him, and power was given unto them over the fourth part of the earth, to kill with sword, and with hunger, and with death, and with the beasts of the earth. I'm going to stop there temporarily. You've probably heard there's a description of the four horsemen of the apocalypse. That's been a famous saying and been used throughout. But it's really the four horsemen of the book of Revelation. It's, you can use whatever you want, the apocalypse. This word apocalypse has become really famous and popular, and movies are being made out of it. I even read a Christian fiction novel about the four horsemen of the apocalypse. And it was all about people trying to come out and take out this rabbi who got saved. And it was just crazy. I read it years ago. And I thought, but each one of them he was one of the four elite soldiers. And I thought, man, they really take and twist scriptures. And it's crazy what they do out there. But we have the four horses and four horsemen in Revelation, and they all have a description. We have, picture the scene, let's picture the scenario. The Father on the throne. The church in heaven, before the throne, represented by John. You have the Lamb of God, Jesus Christ, with the seven sealed book, the 24 elders and the beasts, all in heaven, and something is about to happen. Something drastic. Now we're going to go back to, you probably already know where I'm going to go, but I think we ought to for clarity's sake, Daniel chapter 9. Daniel chapter 9. Before I get into any prophetic topic in Daniel chapter 9, I want you to realize one major, major event that takes place. Before any prophetic words are spoken in Daniel chapter 9. We're quick to go to prophecy, we're quick to go to what it represents, but I want you to see something that is very vital, I believe, in Daniel chapter 9. Daniel chapter 9, verse 1. Daniel chapter 9, verse 1. The Bible says, in the first year of Darius, the son of Ahasuerus, of the seed of the Medes, which was made king over the realm of the Chaldeans, in the first year of his reign, I, Daniel, understood by books the number of the years whereof the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah the prophet, that he would accomplish 70 years in the desolations of Jerusalem. What does Daniel say? I read the books. What books did he read? Well, he gives the name of one of the guys who wrote the book specifically that he read, Jeremiah. What was he saying? I read in the books, and in one particular book I read about 70 years of destruction of Jerusalem. I read in the scriptures. What is Daniel saying? I read the scriptures. Before you get into the prophecy teaching, remember one thing. First of all, read the scriptures. First of all, read the scriptures. I picked up a magazine that came to the church. I picked it up and I just looked at it. and it was on End Times Prophecies. I haven't read the magazine yet. I looked at the magazine, it's on End Times Prophecies. I opened it up and I looked at who wrote the article. Then I thought back to how somebody else mentioned this guy in an article and says, he doesn't believe the way we do. He takes scriptures and twists them. And I thought, interesting. I haven't read it yet. Don't know if I'm going to. Haven't planned on it. Why? Because if I'm studying the book of Revelation, I'm studying end times prophetic events, and I'm going to get up here and preach, and I start reading that for my study, it could very clearly take a hold of my mind and influence me and my thinking. So where do I need to go? The scriptures. I need to study the scriptures. I want you to see something else that takes place. Before you get into anything prophetic, number one, read the scriptures. Number two, verse 3. And I set my face unto the Lord God to seek by prayer and supplications with fasting and sackcloth and ashes. And I prayed unto the Lord my God and made my confession and said, O Lord, the great and dreadful God, keeping the covenant and mercy to them that love him and to them that keep his commandments, we have sinned and have committed iniquity, and have done wickedly, and have rebelled, even by departing from thy precepts and from thy judgments. Neither have we hearkened unto thy servants, the prophets, which spake in thy name to our kings, our princes, and our fathers, and to all the people of the land. O Lord, righteousness belongeth unto thee, but unto us confusion of faces as at this day. And as you read it down, you realize this. There's two things before the prophetic events and teachings in chapter 9 come into play. There's two major events. Studying the scriptures, confession of sin, getting right with God. Why? Because without a studying of the scriptures and without a good walk with God, without a clear conscience toward God, we can easily be swayed by anything that comes along. Anything that comes along. We've got to have a walk with God, confess your sins and get them right, read the scriptures. Or else, you know what's going to happen when you start studying prophetic events? I can name preachers who preached many of the, they believed the way I believe. They used to. They believed what the scriptures teach. The way I believe the scriptures clearly teach them. But over time they got off into the manipulation of people and things and undermining governments and authorities, and they got into all kinds of other different realms, and before long they came out teaching other doctrines and other things, and well, this is really what it means now. This, and they changed their beliefs. There was a man I love a lot of his old works. I've got a stack of DVDs of his. He was a science creation. Now, there's some things I disagreed on, minor here and there. But he was a science creation guy. He just really put a lot of evolutionists to shame by just showing them clarity and clarity and clarity. He used a lot of scriptures and logical reasoning as well to prove to them, you're off your rocker. Then he got into the big tax evasion stuff and all kinds of just crazy stuff. And he'd go into churches and teach them how you can avoid paying taxes. You know what? As a believer, what did Jesus say? Guys, go fishing. Catch a fish. Get the money out. Pay your taxes and mine. Just do it. It's not a moral issue. It's a you have to do it because your government said. It's not a big moral thing. Do I like paying taxes? No. But do I like having police officers, fire department? Yes. Do I like the way our education system is? No. Do I like some of the things my taxes fund? No. It's not that big a deal. Just do it. Just do it. It's not a moral issue. It is a moral issue when you fight your government on something that's not a moral issue. And Jesus told us, go pay. Go pay. Why? because you are a slave to a different government. Do you know that, yes, I'm American, but technically I'm a slave to the American government? I'm a child of God. He's my king. He's my authority. So this is not my home. So therefore, when it comes down to it, though I live in America and I am declared a citizen, this is not my permanent residency. That's what he's telling the Jewish people. Look, this might be your homeland, but you answer to Rome, pay the taxes, do what you're supposed to pay. The children are not supposed to have to pay taxes to their own government. That's what Jesus said. The government is supposed to tax those that are under its subjection outside of its government. They demand tribute. That'd be a problem. So he was trying to teach all this stuff, ended up in jail, and while the preacher's in jail, he starts studying the scriptures, and ends up finding out, oh, it's all different now. Well, you're living, thinking everything's great, going around trying to teach churches how to evade taxes and all that, and you get to the point where it's like, can you honestly tell me the guy who studied scriptures and right with God? I don't know that I could honestly say he was. That is true with God. But also this belief started changing. So I want you to remember, when you start studying prophecy or scriptures on prophecy, remember this. First of all, study the scriptures, not just what somebody else says. And two, make sure your heart's right. Lord, give me clarity of thought. Quickly, we're going to go down. Stay in Daniel chapter 9, verse 19. He says, O Lord, hear. Daniel 9, 19. O Lord, hear. O Lord, forgive. O Lord, hearken and do. Defer not for thine own sake, O my God, for thy city and thy people are called by thy name. And whilst I was speaking and praying and confessing my sin and the sin of my people Israel, and presenting my supplication before the Lord my God for the holy mountain of my God, yea, whilst I was speaking in prayer, even the man Gabriel, whom I had seen in the vision at the beginning, being caused to fly swiftly, touched me about the time of the evening oblation. And he informed me and talked with me and said, O Daniel, I am now come forth to give thee skill and understanding. At the beginning of thy supplications, the commandment came forth, and I am come to show thee, for thou art greatly beloved. Therefore, understand the matter and consider the vision. And then here comes the vision of what we call Daniel's 70 weeks. They're not Daniel's 70 weeks. It has nothing to do with Daniel. As a matter of fact, Daniel has no clue. This is all after Daniel. But he does get a vision and understanding. And it says this, verse 24, 70 weeks are determined upon thy people and upon thy holy city to finish the transgression. I want you to remember this. He says, upon thy people and upon thy holy city. There's 70 weeks that are determined upon the Hebrew people. Clearly, other people can be caught up in it, but it specifically clarified that it is for the Hebrew people to get clarity on who God really is. God brings signs and wonders for the Jews, not for the Gentiles. We don't need signs and wonders. We have the Word of God and we have the stories of the Jewish people, what they went through. We don't need signs and wonders. 70 weeks. To finish the transgression, and to make an end of sins, and to make reconciliation for iniquity, and to bring in everlasting righteousness, and to seal up the vision and prophecy, and to anoint the most holy. Know therefore, verse 25, and understand that from the going forth of the commandment, to restore and to build Jerusalem. That is, after Jerusalem has been destroyed, to restore it. That takes place in the book of Nehemiah, where Artaxerxes declares to rebuild Jerusalem. From when he declares it, unto the Messiah, the prince shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. Why doesn't he just say 69 weeks? Why doesn't he just say? Because if you study the clarity of the history of it, looking back, we can see that the 7 weeks are exactly what it took to restore Jerusalem. And each time it says weeks, it's talking about a week or a year. Okay? So if you study it out pretty clearly, these are going to be 7 weeks or 7 weeks of years. So the first seven refers to 49 years. It took 49 years to restore Jerusalem. So he could have said 79 years, but he didn't. He gave a little period in there, which is part of the 39 weeks, but he gave a specific 7 weeks. There's going to be something different, which was the restoration. Then the 32 weeks, which are added to the seven, the Messiah comes, and if you study it out, 39 times 7, I don't remember, the 483 years, from 483 years from when Jerusalem was declared to be restored until Jesus Christ made his triumphal entry into Jerusalem and was crucified. There you have the first 69 weeks. The 70th week, you'll find out clearly. It says, 62 weeks, the streets shall be built again, the wall, even in troublous times. And Jerusalem was rebuilt during troublous times. It says, verse 26, and after 62 weeks, shall Messiah be cut off, but not for himself. He was going to die. That was his crucifixion. He was going to be cut off, but not for himself. He wasn't dying for himself. You know who you die for? You know who you die for? You die for you. You know who he died for? He died for you too. You died for you, but Jesus didn't die for himself. He says he should be cut off, but not for himself. He didn't die for himself, he died for you. And the people of the prince that shall come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary, and the end thereof shall be with the flood, and at the end of the war desolations are determined. And he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week. Here it is, very clearly, the confirmation. The last 7 years are Jesus Christ confirmation of who he is. He's confirming to the Jewish people, I am who I said I was. I will do what I said I was going to do. And I'm giving you 7 more years of clarity. He gave them 7 for the restoring of Jerusalem. He gave them the next 62 weeks of years until the coming of the Messiah. And then he says, I'm going to give you 1 more 7. And that is what we call the Daniel 70th week, or the Bible also calls the Great Tribulation. Remember this, not just tribulation, because you and I are going to go through tribulations if we're living for God. But there's a specific Great Tribulation, a period of 7 weeks. Why? It's only to confirm with the Hebrew people that he is who he said he was. He's going to do what he said he was going to do. Signs and wonders are for the Hebrew people. Study it out. And that's what that 7 weeks, or 7 weeks of years, the 7 years of tribulation, Great Tribulation, the 70th week, that's what it is. It is God's confirmation to the Hebrew people. I told you, and I told you, and I told you, and I told you. I'll give you 1 more confirmation. And then he comes and rules and reigns. So, hope we have some clarity. We'll get back into that before we get back into it. Our Heavenly Father, I do thank you for the Word of God, the Scriptures. I pray that we will study the Word of God, rightly dividing the Word of truth, not taking it out of context. And when we do, because we're human and our flesh gets in there, forgive us. Help us to go back and correct ourselves by studying the Word of God. We're not correcting the Word of God by what we think. Thank you for what you've taught me and the men that have taken the time to show me from the Bible how I ought to live my life.